Have you ever heard of the Soviet Object 299?
Yeah, me neither.
Until someone suggested in the comment section of another video that I make a video about this vehicle because it's a tank that no one really talks about. And that's why I googled a bit about the tank and found out that it's a design from the late 1980s, a time when everyone was busy staring at the T-72 and T-80 like they were the Soviet Kardashians of armored vehicles. During this time, a team of engineers in Leningrad was quietly designing a super tank that never made it to mass production. This experimental concept, the Object 299, was quite ahead of its time, and it foreshadowed tank designs we wouldn't see for decades. In this video, we will look at what the Object 299 was, why it existed, and why it doesn't exist anymore. And to be honest, I myself found it surprisingly interesting, so enjoy this video. For context, during the Cold War, Soviet engineers developed the idea of a tank of extreme parameters, which was essentially a tank pushed to the absolute limits of firepower, protection and mobility. The philosophy was that alongside the regular main battle tanks, which were mass-produced and relatively affordable, the army could use a small number of super tanks packed with the latest technology. Think of it like the car industry. You have your reliable sedans, which would be MBTs, and then you have high-end concept cars with all the experimental features, which would be the extreme tanks. The Object 299 was exactly this kind of concept, a tank with maxed out specs in every category. In 1988, under the guidance of chief designer Nikolai Popov, the Leningrad-Kirov factory's design bureau started designing the Object 299 as part of a program named Improvement 2 or Leader 2000 to 2005. Bold move, considering that the Soviet Union itself didn't make it to the 2000s. The idea was to have this tank ready by the end of the millennium. Several Soviet design bureaus were simultaneously working on the next-gen tanks around that time, and the Object 299 was Leningrad's entry into that race. We've seen these kinds of tank design competitions quite often in Soviet tank history. Anyways, the tank was envisioned as a 50-ton vehicle, not much heavier than a T-80, but with far superior armor, firepower, and electronics. Importantly, the Object 299's base chassis could be used for a main battle tank as well, or for a heavy infantry fighting vehicle, a missile-armed tank destroyer, self-propelled artillery, an air defense system, and engineering vehicles, and so on. So, what made the Object 299 so special? Well, basically everything. The designers threw out a lot of traditional tank design features and went with bold, sometimes radical solutions. For one, unlike standard tanks where most of the crew sits in the turret, the Object 299's crew would sit in a heavily armored crew capsule in the middle of the hull, behind the engine. Basically, the tank designers decided that the best armor was other parts of the tank. This is similar in concept to modern designs like the T-14 Armata, but was unheard of in the 1980s. The idea was to maximize crew protection by putting as much armor and hardware in front of them as possible. The engine was therefore moved to the front of the tank to act as an extra shield, just as Israel did with the Merkava tank. In fact, the tank only had two crew members, a driver and a commander who also served as a gunner, thanks to a high degree of automation. Around the crew compartment, they built a multi-layered armored capsule which, according to design reports, had about 250 mm of its own armor, as well as reactive armor plates on top equivalent to 800 mm. Even the crew hatches were 300 mm thick. In total, the Object 299's frontal protection was estimated equivalent to over 1,100 mm of steel armor against kinetic shells, and about 1,400 mm against shaped charge warheads. Apparently, someone thought the answer to how safe is safe was yes. That's roughly double the protection of earlier tanks, which is insane. And the philosophy behind this much armor is pretty straightforward. In combat, a tank doesn't survive long in intense fighting, so they wanted to give the crew the best chance to survive and keep fighting in that short lifespan at the front. By enclosing them in a fortified capsule, even if the tank's outer parts got hit or the turret blew off, the crew might live and fight for another day. I don't know how to feel about this, to be honest, but anyways. The Object 299 was armed with a massive 152mm gun. To put that in perspective, most Soviet tanks, and indeed even most modern Russian tanks today, use a 125mm gun, and Western tanks use a 120mm gun. However, a big gun posed a challenge. How do you load it and carry enough ammo? Obviously, Bigger rounds take more space, which means you can carry less unless you make the tank bigger. If that's impossible, you have to get creative, and the designers choose to get creative. They use an unmanned turret, or more accurately a low-profile weapon station, at the back of the tank. Having no humans in the turret meant it could be smaller and safer for the crew. They created a fully automated loading system that used a ring-shaped mechanism with a vertical chest set on ammo storage. But that's not it. They did something wild with the ammo as well. To keep the turret compact, they developed new telescoping ammunition. This means the shell and its propellant charge could be partly collapsed into itself to shorten its length, then extended to full length when ready to fire, like a Russian Matryoshka doll. Usually a 152mm round might be about 1.8 meters long. They managed to reduce it to about 1.2 meters by this telescopic design. This transformer shell allowed them to store a lot more ammo in a limited space. In fact, the Object 299 was supposed to carry 40 rounds of 152mm ammunition, all in mechanized storage, which is quite impressive since most tanks carry 40 to 45 rounds of smaller caliber, but the Object 299 carried 40 massive ones. The Object 299's turret would also have been outfitted with at least 2 radar units of active protection systems, basically mini interceptors to shoot down incoming anti-tank missiles. So firepower-wise, the Object 299 would have been an absolute beast. A single hit from that 152mm gun could obliterate most targets, and even near misses with high explosive shells would be devastating. Usually, when you stack a tank with absorbed armor and a cannon the size of a city ordnance violation, you end up with something that moves like a dying refrigerator, basically like we know Soviet heavy tanks. But the team behind the Object 299 tried hard to avoid that. They chose a gas turbine engine, similar to what the T-80 tank used, for high power. Initially, a 1,500 horsepower turbine was planned, but they envisioned upgrading it to 1,800 or even 2,000 horsepower over time. With about 1,500 horsepower, their calculations showed that the Object 299 could reach speeds of about 80 to 90 kilometers an hour on roads, and with 1,800 horsepower, possibly up to 95 kilometers an hour, which is almost 60 miles per hour. So basically as fast as a truck. At that point, it wasn't clear whether the designers wanted to win wars or just terrify the laws of aerodynamics. Essentially, the Object 299 would have handling like a much lighter tank. High power to weight ratio and modern suspension meant it could accelerate quickly and traverse obstacles more easily than older designs. The designers even talked about giving it an electromechanical transmission and auxiliary generator for future upgrades, which hints at hybrid drive or at least advanced power management, which was very forward-thinking in the 80s. The trade-off for all that would have been fuel consumption. Gas turbines famously need a lot of fuel. But interestingly, at about 1,500 horsepower, the Soviet turbine engine was said to have fuel consumption comparable to a diesel of the same power, so it might not have been too thirsty for what it delivered. Now, the designers understood that raw armor and speed weren't enough anymore. A modern tank needs a brain as well. That's why they planned to equip it with state-of-the-art digital fire control systems, sensors, and even elements of what they referred to as technical vision and artificial intelligence. Now, AI in the late 80s wasn't what we think of today, so take that with a grain of salt. It likely means advanced target tracking, diagnostic systems, and partial automation of certain tasks. For example, an automated driver assistance that could help drive the tank, or a system to automatically identify targets through the sights. The tank would have needed sophisticated electronics to manage that unmanned turret, the active protection radar and interceptors, and communicate with other units. The designers even imagined microprocessor complexes controlling many systems, which in plain terms means that they were going to use computer processors to handle things that earlier tanks did manually or with analog electronics. This level of automation was intended to reduce the workload on the crew, which is important when you only want 2 people inside. However, you're probably smart enough to know that designing something on paper is one thing and dragging it out of a realm of PowerPoint and actually building and testing it is another. So, what happened when they tried to bring the Object 299 to life? Let's find out. By the early 1990s, the Leningrad design team had made significant progress. They actually built a prototype chassis for the Objekt 299 without the full turret. This prototype had all the unusual layout features: the engine in the front, the space for the crew capsule behind it, and the extended rear section where the turret and ammo would go. It likely used an existing engine, perhaps the 1250 horsepower or 1500 horsepower turbine, and was fitted with loads to simulate the weight of armor and turret. Interestingly, the testbed had an openable top with a glass dome for the crew in some trials, basically turning the capsule into an open-topped cockpit for the sake of test visibility and ventilation. This test vehicle was sometimes called a running mock-up. This running mock-up actually worked. It rolled, it accelerated, it terrified local birds, and it underwent extensive mobility trials in the late 80s and up to 1993. According to reports, the prototype performed well in tests. It met the expected speed and agility parameters. Engineers drove it hard over various terrains, and it apparently validated that even a 50-ton tank with this layout could hit speeds and handle rough ground. Of course, as with any experimental machine, it wasn't perfect. One issue noted was thermal interference. Having a roaring gas turbine engine at the front could mess with the tank's sides and sensors due to heat and exhaust, potentially blurring the view or infrared picture. Soviet engineers recognized this might be a problem and started working on mitigating that with insulation and better placement. Another problem was that even without the crew in the turret needed heavy protection because of the ammo inside. The vertical ammo arrangement made the turret quite tall, about 3 meters high at the roof, which was much taller than previous tanks. A T-72's turret, for example, was about 2.2 meters in the air. This means that the Objekt 299 would present a bigger silhouette, and they struggled to fully protect that big unmanned turret while keeping the weight in check. These were solvable problems, just the kind that required time, money, and a functioning country. Three things that the early 1990s politely took off the table. The project was moving forward, and by all accounts, the designers were optimistic. They believed that after some tweaking, they could build a fully functional Objekt 299 tank and then spin off the variants of that chassis. By around 1990, the plan for the whole unified family of vehicles was already sketched out. To give you an idea of the scope, here's what they envisioned on the Objekt 299 platform. Firstly, a main battle tank, the core Objekt 299 with a 152mm gun, the primary tank variant. Then, a heavy infantry fighting vehicle, a troop carrier with thick armor. By raising the rear section, they could fit 11 infantry soldiers inside along with supplies and put a remote-controlled turret on top with smaller cannon, machine gun and grenade launcher, essentially an IFV as well protected as a tank. Then, a missile tank, basically a tank destroyer, a variant that replaces the big gun with a vertical launch missile system. They proposed installing 30 missiles in vertical tubes in the back of compartment, capable of launching anti-tank or multi-purpose missiles upward. The idea sounds like a mix between an MLRS and a tank, useful for long-range engagements, knocking out enemy armor or even fortifications from a distance. Then, self-propelled artillery, short SPA, a version with a large caliber howitzer in a fully rotating, but still unmanned turret for indirect fire support. They considered calibers of 152mm or even larger for this, effectively making it a heavy assault gun or artillery piece on the same chassis. Then, an air defense system. Although less information is available about this, the family was stated to include an anti-aircraft system, likely mounting air defense missiles or automatic anti-air guns on the Objekt 299 chassis. With the mobility and protection of this platform, an AA vehicle could keep up with tank units at the front lines and survive in high-risk environments. And lastly, engineering vehicles. They imagined armored engineering vehicles, for example a breaching vehicle with a dozer blade or mine plow, maybe a bridge layer or recovery vehicle as well, built on the same platform. One concept was even an uncrewed robotic engineering vehicle for dangerous tasks like mine clearing using remote control technology. It's clear that the team saw the Objekt 299 as a universal battlefield chassis. If that sounds exactly like what the Russian Armata program in 2015 turned out to be, congratulations, you've just spotted a 25-year-old déjà vu. In fact, Russian military writers explicitly called the Object 299 the direct ideological predecessor of the Armata platform. The T-14 and T-15 and the rest of the Armata family are basically the ghost of the Object 299 finally getting a second chance. Same dream, newer PowerPoint slide. So, with all these big plans and even a prototype running, why did the Object 299 never become reality? In one word, money. Or more precisely, the majestic absence of it. The Object 299 was born at an unfortunate time, the late 80s and early 90s, which was when the Soviet Union was collapsing economically and politically. By 1991, the USSR broke apart and the Russian Federation was in deep financial crisis. Military budgets were slashed drastically at the turn of the 80s and 90s. In that chaos, many advanced projects were cancelled outright. The Object 299 was, sadly, one of the victims of these cancellations. In 1993, after the prototype chassis had done its trials, the funding was stopped. But to be fair, even if the USSR hadn't collapsed, the Object 299 would still have been an expensive tank. All those new technologies, the gas turbine engine, the fancy autoloader, the heavy armor, electronics, and so on, would have cost a fortune per unit. One Russian source later quipped that even thinking about the price tag of a 2000 horsepower turbine for a tank was terrifying, which makes sense. It's not often that you invent something so powerful it scares your own finance department. So in a harsher economic reality, it was an obvious program to cut. But as we all know, hope dies last, so the team at the Kirov plant tried to keep the dream on life support through the 1990s, pitching the Object 299 to anyone in uniform who would listen. There were efforts to maybe get a scaled-down version funded or to integrate some of its innovations into other projects. In the end, however, Russia's tank development focus shifted. By the 2000s, most tank R&D was consolidated under Ural Vagonzavod in Nizhny Tagil, which was a different design bureau that was working on its own next-generation tank, the Object 195, aka the T-95. That project, which also had a 152mm gun and an unmanned turret, itself got cancelled around 2010, clearing the way for what eventually became the T-14 Armata. Essentially, the Object 299 and its Leningrad designers never got a second chance. It remained a set of blueprints, a test at all, and a lot of what-ifs potential. One tangible piece of Object 299's legacy is that prototype hull. Reportedly, it survived for some years. Some sources suggest it might have ended up as a target on a firing range eventually. It wouldn't be the first prototype to meet such an end. In any case, after the early 90s, hardly anyone in the public knew it even existed until details started surfacing in the 2000s when declassified or discussed by historians. Now, you might be thinking, why should we care about a tank that never went beyond the prototype stage? The significance of the Object 299 is that many of its radical ideas didn't die, they just went into hibernation and re-emerged later. The clearest legacy is the concept of a universal armored platform with an unmanned turret and crew in a protected capsule. This is precisely what the modern T-14 Armata is, and Russian experts openly acknowledge the Armata as a successor of the Object 299. When you see the Armata's features, engine in the front, crew of three in an armored capsule, unmanned turret, although with a 125mm gun for now, active protection system and plans for variants like a tank, a heavy IFV, artillery and so on, you're essentially seeing the same blueprint that the Object 299 laid out. It just took a few decades and better finances for those ideas to be realized. So next time someone talks about the latest high technology tank, you can casually mention, well, the Soviets had a concept back in the 80s that did something similar. Chances are no one will have heard of the Object 299, and now you will be the one to tell its story. After all, it's a tank that no one talks about, and that's why you watch this video, because it's absolutely worth talking about. So that was it for today. Don't forget to check out my YouTube membership if you want to support me, and my Patreon if you want to see the questionable stuff I find while researching for my videos. And see you next time.